derived in this Planck mission that has been a reality and has produced many fantastic results that we will talk about, we will listen today about. Today what he's going to do is he's going to make a summary of the results that Planck has produced. He's going to make also a global view of the legacy that Planck is leaving for astronomy for the next years, and also about the future plans of this community that, of course, is still very active and has many, many ideas and things that should be done in the next years. Okay, then, Enrique, welcome, and it's your time now. Okay.
Thank you very much. So, good morning. I'm going to talk about the Planck Cosmological Legacy. As you know, Planck is a mission and is already finished several years ago, but still the Planck collaboration continue analyzing the data that the mission produced, and we are still finishing the last papers of the last release, which is the third release, and is really the legacy of Planck in it. So, if I have time at the end, I would like to talk about the next CMB experiments, but hope to have time, because I think it's interesting. So, Planck is really a successful mission. It started, as Anshon mentioned, in 1993, when Cobra Samba, there were two different missions proposed by two different consortia, and at the end ESA proposed to merge both missions, and at the end we finished with it was selected for phase A in next year, and then as M3, the MIDI mission, and it was named Planck later on. So it was launched in 2009, and it was having measurements of the CMB for 4 years. So these 4 years is for at least one of the instruments. It has two instruments, and the other instrument, the high frequency instrument, was really 30 months, not 2 years, but one. So the main goal was to image the temperature and polarization of the CMB over the whole sky at 5 arc minutes resolution with a large frequency coverage and a sensitivity limited only by cosmic variance and the ability to remove the astrophysical forums. This was the purpose of this mission. So, Plan, as I already said, had two consortia that were responsible of two instruments, the low-frequency instruments and the high-frequency instruments. I participated very much in the low-frequency instrument as a COI, and this is based on radiometers and covering this frequency range from 30 to 70 GHz, three different bands, frequency bands, cooled at 20 Kelvin. In Santander, we contributed with one of the modules of the radiometers at 30 and 44 GHz. these were the back, what we call the backend modules, and they were having amplification and detection of the signal. And the high frequency instrument is a completely different technology based on bolometers, covering the high frequency from 100 to 857 GHz, and cool at 100 millikelvin, typical temperature for the bolometers. So the nominal mission was only 15 months. And as I said, the minimum time for of one of the instruments, we're working for a factor of two more. So at the end, we have 4 sky surveys for the high frequency instrument and 8 for the low one. The end of operations were in October 2013. Well, the scanning strategy follows this, what you can see there. It was pointed, of course, aligned with the sun in the Lagrange point 2, and it was covering in this way the sky, 180, almost 180 degrees circles. And then it is going around the sun. It covered the whole sky in 7 months. So two skies per year, basically. And there were three releases, as it is said here, 2013, public releases, 2015 and 18. So this is a picture in 2001 at STEC, and we were like 150 people discussing and fabricating and creating the Planck mission. And this is one recent one in December, it was in ISAC, and this we are a bit older and less people and new faces here too. So so the detectors, as I said, covers nine frequency bands divided in two instruments. These are the low frequency and the high frequency. And only from 30 to 353, they are polarization sensitive. These two highest frequency ones are not. These are the angular resolution, as you can see, goes from 30 to 4 arc minutes. And these are the number of months and the temperature, noise temperature, and polarization noise temperature. Okay. So, in summary, these are the publications made by Planck. So, we have at the beginning Planck technical results. The first year, like 47 publications describing the instruments, basically, and DPCs and working groups. And then Planck papers, early papers. And then here we have the intermediate results of Planck. And this is named by for separation from the releases, the Planck cosmological results, which are given in three different releases in 2013, 15, and 18. This is the last one I'm going to concentrate on. These intermediate results are results which are astrophysical in general, and they normally they don't they are not included in the core science of Planck, which is the cosmology. So this is the frequency maps delivered in last summer. They are public, and you can find them in the Planck Legacy archives. And from them, we are able to construct a clean CMB temperature map with also a mask, which is provided. We call it common mask because there are four methods to derive this clean map for different methods. And then this is the common mask decided by the four methods. And this is the CMB in temperature. So to get this clean map, we have to go through cleaning of the data. In particular, considering that in intensity we have several foregrounds, thermal dust, synchrotron, free-free, and also CO lines. And in polarization, the situation is simpler in the sense that there are only two, as far as we know, there are two main foregrounds, which are the thermal dust and the synchrotron. It might be also other foregrounds, like, for instance, we don't know if the anomalous emission, what we call in microwave anomalous emission, which is due to the spinning dust, it's not thermal emission, but it's spinning dust emission, that can be polarized. But as far as we know, we only have upper limits on this, and we don't know at which level, if at all, they are polarized. So in principle, we have these two main components that we have to care about. And this is the situation in terms of the power spectra, spatial power spectra, right? This is in frequency, this is a function of multiple. And as you can see, the situation is much cleaner because this is for a given frequency, the best frequency in Planck in terms of both foregrounds and sensitivity. And you see that in this, let's say 50 to 80% of the sky, the CMB can be seen clearly above the contaminants. This is not the situation in polarization. This is the E-mode polarization. You know that there are two Stokes parameters, Q and U. Normally, in cosmology, we work with invariant quantities, which are E and B. So from Q and U, it is possible by a non-local transformation to go from QU to EB, which are invariant quantities. And this is the E one. And you can see that the CMB is below almost at all frequencies, except maybe this frequency. But still, at this frequency, we cannot see the smallest multiples, which are the critical ones, the key ones, to derive the optical depth of the universe for the microwave photons. So this is the situation. So one thing that is interesting to notice is that there is no, contrary to what happens for T and E, there is no B-mode hole in the sky at the level to reach sensitivities for the primordial gravitational wave amplitude of the order of 10 to minus 2. So for the B-mode, the situation is much more difficult, and we will really have to clean very well the sky in order to reach this level and below in amplitude. Okay. So this is the situation in polarization, the maps at the different frequencies in Q, U, and P. And this is just to show that we have improved significantly from this release to the previous release in 2015. I don't want to enter in details, but basically the noise is at this level in 2018. And it was at this level previously. So this is what was removed in the previous release because of this contamination, and now is delivered. We have access to all the multiples, and we analyze all the multiples. And that's the reason we have improved, in particular, in the tau, in the value of the tau parameter, the optical depth. So this is the map of polarization on top of the temperature one, and the polarization now here is this segments, right? There is no arrow here for Q and U. It's smooth at 5 degrees. And from here, just to see how precise Planck is, we can catch 10 by 10 degrees, and you can still see very well the patterns. And from here, we take another pattern of 2 by 2 degrees, and this was a 20 Hermite resolution, and we can see still very well the polarization pattern. This is 2.5 by 2.5 degrees smooth at 7 R minutes.
Excuse me, which is the physical mechanism that provides CMB radiation?
Yes, so the physical mechanism is related to two epochs. One is the epoch of recombination, and the other is the epoch of reionization. So the epoch of recombination is, well, in both cases, is compton scattering. So the compton scattering, yeah. So and most of the signal comes from recombination, but only at the smallest scales, in multiples, the smallest multiples is reionization which dominates, and that's the reason we can infer the tau parameter, because of the low order multiples below 10, and this is what is more difficult to get from the data because, as I mentioned, because of the foregrounds that dominate at this.
So reionization is related to polarized absorption of photons by matter?
Reionization is when the universe becomes reionized again, and then we can have this interaction again, quantum scattering with electrons, and then again we have this polarization. And this is affecting mostly only to the low order multiples. Okay. So what is really new from Planck is the gravitational lensing. This information is also got from the data, from the temperature and polarization data, and it can, in particular, construct this lensing deflection field map that you can see here, and also this becomes and independent data to constrain the cosmological parameters. And it's a way to break the generalities that otherwise remained in the CMB information, right? So with lensing, we can break somewhat in particular, the geometrical degeneracy already. what I said before. So, and also we can construct a map. This is a noisy map, let's say, because per pixel of 10 degrees we have a signal to noise of the order of one. And as a whole, this signal is, in the best case, we add in external tracers, we can find the signal averaging over all the map at the 4 sigma. So it's not a huge. This is something that theoretically we know that there is a limitation in getting this signal because it's weak. And due to cosmic variance, because the integrated source wolf is only dominating at the very large scales, then cosmic variance is very important, and this is the main limitation here. Okay, so this is a summary of the Planck results that are not only cosmological, but many other pieces of science, in astrophysics in particular, but in, the most important one is the most precise picture of the universe that we have got with Planck, and it is really Planck, I think, which has really defined very well and constrains very, very much the six cosmological parameters of the Lambda CDM model. And that's the reason we now believe that this is the best model of our universe, right? If Planck has a lot of influence in this. So, also it has characterized the isotropy, the two very important and basic components and fundamental components of the cosmological model. Properties of the cosmological model is isotropy and Gaussianity. Also, we have constrained inflationary parameters, the basic ones. We will see this later. Primordial Gaussianity, fundamental physics. We have produced a map of the lensing potential and redshift approximate to measure the integrated source wolf. We have produced also a map of the cosmic infrared background. it's an all sky map, of course. We are only able to see this background after also cleaning the dust, and then basically is coming this information from 50% of the sky. Then we have detected through this Sundiata-Saldovich effect of the order of 1600 clusters, measure also the kinetic Sundiata-Saldovich effect. Extragalactic sources in the form of radio, quasars or radio galaxies, and infrared sources, diffuse information on the diffuse galactic components from synchrotron, free, thermal dust, spinning, magnetic field, galactic sources like cold cores, H2 regions, young star forming regions, and also the best determination of the solar dipole. Probably there are more results, but these are the summary I have for the main ones. So, for the cosmology, we have used, mainly for constraining the cosmological parameters, we used this, when we only talk about Planck data, we use these four power spectra, which are the temperature, which is limited by only cosmic variance up to 1700 in multipoles, the cross spectrum between temperature and e-polarization. You can see this is the blue line is the model, the best fit model, and the red lines with the arrow bars is the data. So you see by eye how well the model fits the data for the four power spectra. This is the EE spectrum, and this is the lensing potential power spectrum. So. As it's clear by eye that the agreement is excellent. We already knew that from previous the previous release, but now it's confirmed by this new and improved release. So these are the six Lambda CDM model parameters, which are given here. And this is the precision with only Planck data, these four power spectra I just showed, and in combination with the BAO, BAO information, baryonic acoustic oscillations, which from the point of view of Planck is considered as a very clean measurement involving linear scales, which is 150 megaparsecs, and therefore nonlinear physics related to galaxy formation and other nonlinear processes are not affecting this measurement. That's the reason that the main external data set with which Planck data is combined with is the Bau information. So you can see Bau is used to break the degeneracies, is improving in some cases the constraints, but basically from here to here you don't see much difference also, right? This means, as I can show later, that the Bau data is very much consistent with Planck data. And that's the result it is, of course, combined. So when we these are derived parameters, from these are the basic ones, and then we can derive these others, in particular the Hubble parameter, which is the one which has had more controversy in these recent years because of the resultol result from supernovas that claim that the H naught is 71 or something, is 3.6 sigma, inconsistent with this result. I am going to mention this a bit more later. So, and these are also one parameter extensions, but any of them, a curvature of the space, mass of neutrinos, number of relativistic species, and the presence of primordial gravitational waves, none of them is detected by Planck. It's not, the data doesn't require to introduce this new, any of these new extra parameters. So with the six parameters, the fit is enough, and is very good. So the best, all the parameters, from these six, five of them, and except the tau, the optical depth, are measured now with a precision better than 1%. But there is a case, which is the best measure parameter, which is the angular scale of the sun horizon as recombination, which is the one used for really normalize the BAOs, right, from galaxy surveys, is measured with this precision 0.03%. A scaling variant, on the other hand, is ruled out at significant, very high significance, 8 sigma. It's something that, in a sense, goes favoring the basic ideas of inflation. There is no evidence of running index or tensor fluctuations, no need for extension. And then there is tension, I already mentioned the Hubble constant, but also a bit moderate, it's difficult to say how much tension is with this observations of galaxy, the galaxy survey and in relation to omega parameter, the matter parameter. Sorry. So, Planck can be also compared with other more resolution CMB experiments, in particular SPT and ACT from Antarctic and from Atacama, can extend very nicely Planck data. Planck data comes to here, and this is the best fit model, which goes very well with these extensions in T, E, and then this is the B mode, but coming from the E mode through lensing. As you know, probably know, there is an effect that the even if we don't have this signature of the B, primordial B mode in the polarization, it would be in the B mode, still we have that the microwave photons suffer lensing, and lensing, a part of the E mode goes to B through lensing. So lensing is really producing this power in B, which is not primordial. And it has been nicely detected by several experiments, in particular the Bicep and Keck one here. And this is for T and the gravitational lensing again. So combined with other experiments, CMB experiments, you see the very nice agreement, and also we can say that we can cover now seven orders of magnitude in sensitivity, from temperature to the lensing B mode. So we can also compare with previous release, in particular 2015, and you see some changes, as denoted here, but always at a small level of the order of below one sigma. And you can see here, for instance, that this is some changes are due to a better, since now in this release we have information on the low multiples, and we are able to extract the information from here, most of this information in polarization is used to constrain the optical depth, as I mentioned before, and therefore having a better determination, as it is here, of the optical depth, it has moved to lower values from previous release. With this is affecting also other parameters like the amplitude or sigma 8, which are related to this one, are correlated with this one, and you see the change in general to smaller values, as you can see here. There are other systematics that has been improved in this release, in particular the beam leakage, that is a systematic that temperature goes to polarization, and you mistake polarization with temperature, and then correcting this, we are able then to make a better constraint on the parameter of omega baryonic, and the blue ones, this one, yeah, which is the sun horizon. And then there are other effects that compensate. Well, overall, this is the change. It's not much, but it's a slight change. We can also see a consistency between different ranges of multiples. And basically, here, there is an exercise dividing all the power information between low L and high L, and dividing at 800 multiple. Basically, it's the same information, same signal to noise, in the low than in the high, and also 800 can be considered the information provided already by WMAP. As you can see, there are small shifts, and there was a controversy in previous years as whether if WMAP was in tension with Planck, and there were differences, but it was not clear how to interpret there. Basically, now what we believe is that this is just a simple shift towards the true value, in the sense that Planck has more information than WMAP, and therefore it is able to constrain better the cosmological parameters, and that's the result. I mean, it's a small shift because it's an extra information, it's a new information. And normally, this is towards, depending on the parameter, omega baryon, omega matter, etc., color matter, omega matter, sorry. And this is a shift towards higher values. But in general, this is the trend. So for higher parameter and the index of the power spectrum, scalar power spectrum, is a shift to lower values. Whereas for omega matter and omega matter times h squared is an increase of the parameters. So from that, we can also construct the linear matter power spectrum. And this covers now three scales, at least, in the linear regime, all this, and 14 billion years in time. All this is in here, and also from here we can also. This is the best fit in your power spectrum with extra data from surveys. You can see here Sloan, etc. And also some people, other authors have been able with this data to constrain the linear power spectrum, including even non-linear corrections at different redshift and redshift 0 or redshift 2. And these are the errors at the level of 2%. We know very well already the power spectrum, even at later times. So now we are going to show different comparisons of Planck with different other external data sets, in particular VPAN nucleosynthesis. As you can see from the helium and deuterium abundances, there is a very good agreement, because this is Planck and this is the narrow value inferred for the density of baryonic density, baryonic matter density, and you can see that very nicely the models of the standard V1 nucleosynthesis, which has certain errors due to the that uncertainty in nuclear rates that are not precisely determined, in particular from deuterium to helium. Still, within these error uncertainties, we can have a very nice agreement in this intersection. So this is a very good agreement. With respect to BAOs, I already advanced that this is also a good agreement, and you can see here in terms of the acoustic scale distance measure, this is an average between the angular distance and the line of sight distance, and as a function of redshift, and this is what is inferred from Planck with the error bars given by the uncertainties in the parameters at different redshifts, and you see the very nice agreement. And the same for when we plot here h in terms of the angular diameter distance, and at three different redshift sets, we can have that when you consider all the Planck power spectra data, this is the red thing here, they intersect at the one sigma level. So the consistency is very good, and that's the reason that normally, very often, to get better constraints in especially several, some parameters, Planck is combined with this BAO measurements. So for redshift space distortions, we have here the growth rate as a function of redshift, and you can see also very, very good agreement. And growth confronted to the Alcock-Pasinski parameter. And again, you see the Planck very small error contours, which are inside the one sigma error bar of Sloan. So here it comes one disagreement, the most important one, which is related to this Ries result based on very local supernovae. And this is a Hucra compilation from the year 2000 till almost 10, and then it has been extended with these new points. And you see a convergence of all these measurements towards this situation at present. And you see that Planck hasn't changed. It's very consistent with itself from in the three releases. And also, the et al. Result is also consistent. And there is this discrepancy that is at the level of 3.6 sigma that is difficult to understand. And when we plot the Hall parameters in terms of redshift, the Kumrovian Hall parameter, we see very nicely this agreement with Bose data and quasars, and well, somewhat not very well with Lyman alpha at different redshifts. And this is confronted here with zero redshift, almost zero redshift, the result by Ries et al., which is clearly outside. And the same when we plot the H naught in front of the omega matter parameter, we can have several cases. In particular, the green one is no Planck data, is BAOs plus another compilation of supernovas, low and high redshift, we call Pantheon, and then deuterium and abundance of pre-planned nucleosynthesis. You have these results, these green contours, which are very nicely in agreement with the Planck results. And this is when we also include BAOs and other data, lensing, Planck lensing, here this one. But you see that the agreement with Planck is very good, but not so much with et al. Result. So we don't know the reason of this. Maybe both are, if both are true values, this means that the lambda CDM model is not good enough to explain our universe. But we don't know yet what is the reason for this discrepancy. And here what is, yeah. So the thing is that this problem, this disagreement, is not confined exclusively to Planck, but also to other cosmological data sets. So we can also confront this with other cosmological datasets. For instance, this has produced cosmic shear data, galaxy lensing and galaxy-galaxy correlation functions. You can see the three. This is the lensing correlation function, which has two modes, plus sign and minus sign, with related to this combination of the tangential correlation, minus or mass or plus the cross lensing. And this is, well, it's difficult to see. This is the best fit, and this is the data. You see the agreement is okay. And also the data using all lensing or all data from this, cosmic shear, galaxy lensing, and lensing. And you can see here the results that the agreement is good when we plot sigma 8 as a function of omega matter. And then in this plot, again, we can have some small discrepancies between Planck and this. And the question here is that, well, this is a moderate tension. It's not so high as in particular for the supernovae. But still, we don't know what is the reason of this. And one reason is that, of course, we are talking here about nonlinear physics, and there are many parameters trying to model this physics that is not so well understood as the linear physics. And in particular, they have to introduce 20 nuisance parameters, and maybe it's related to that, but we don't know. The reason of this small shift. Well, I already said that these are the contours of the standard five cosmological parameters, all of them except the tau, confronted to one extension of the lambda CDM model in terms of curvature, parameter of equation of state, number of relativistic species, mass of neutrinos, etc. And as I already mentioned, at the end, we don't need any of these extra parameters to improve the fit to the Planck data. Also, Planck combined with BAOs. In particular, we want to emphasize the situation for curvature, in which, when we, as I said before, if we only have the temperature and polarization Planck data, we have this degeneracy here between this curvature and matter density. But when we introduce the Planck lensing data, which is Planck again, still Planck, we reduce a lot the degeneracy here. And at the end, when we introduce BAO, the degeneracy is completely broken and it points towards just zero curvature. And the precision in this zero curvature is amazing. Is flat. In other terms, we can say that it's flat to an accuracy of 0.2%. Okay, we can constrain also inflation. In particular, the most favored model up to now is the Stravinsky R2 inflation, which is here, very well within the error bars of the tensor amplitude confronted to the power spectrum index. And we can remove also all the potentials which are monomial with index above one. We can discard this. And we can have this result related to inflation, that we can say that the universe is especially flat, nearly scale invariant, which is in agreement with what is predicted in the simplest inflationary models. In general, is almost a power law, no evidence of running index, dominated by scalar perturbations. So we haven't detected yet, but if they are a primordial tensor perturbation, they are going to be small. Gaussian, this nonlinear coupling parameter for the local case is very much constrained around zero. Adiabatic, we don't have any evidence for isocurvature perturbations, and they have, if they exist, they have to be very, very small. And also a negligible contribution from topological defects, which in terms of the power spectrum has to be less than 1% at the 95% confidence level. So this is all in agreement with the simple ideas of inflation. And here we can see a picture of how consistent is Planck with WMAP in time and with Planck itself. And you can see again the standard six parameters. Well, we have divided this between somewhat early time physics and late time physics parameters. And you can see that this is very much consistent. It's a question of sensitivity in the nonlinear coupling parameter. Inert is the same. There is no inconsistency. It's always no detection and, no detection. And for the scalar index is also a very good consistency towards a very precise value here now, which is slightly non-scaling variant. And for the other parameters, we can see this also this nice trend. The one which maybe has fluctuated more apart from age is tau, which now is given a smaller value, more precise and smaller value than for instance, some results from the first year WMAP data. But apart from that, the evolution in time of the cosmological parameters is very consistent. And, well, this is, okay, so this is the presentation for the major result, cosmological results, in particular related to the cosmological parameters. And now I would like to focus a bit more on an aspect of the Planck results and publications, which is the isotropy and statistics, simply because I have been very much involved in this part of the work. And this is related to a paper that has been submitted a few weeks ago, but is unfortunately not yet in the archive. But we expect to put it in the archive very soon. But it's now been referred in astronomy and astrophysics. So here, what we study is two main characteristics of the cosmological paradigm, which are isotropy and Gaussianity, right? Which is a basic assumption and characteristic of our cosmological model, and with Planck we are able for the first time to really perform a detailed analysis of these fundamental properties. In particular, contrary to what I have already shown in relation to constraints on the cosmological parameters and on the lambda CDM model that were derived from the power spectra, here all the results are derived from maps. So we really need maps here because we want to know if the universe in this side of the sky is different from this side, etc. So for that, we have four different methods working under different assumptions that produce clean CMB maps. You can see the residuals of the galactic foregrounds here in the galactic plane. This is galactic coordinates. And but the, in the rest, in temperature or intensity, the agreement is very good, as can be seen, for instance, here. When we perform differences of these maps, you can see that the difference is at a very small level, a few micro K, except in the galactic center, galactic plane. But I don't know if you can see the common mask, and that's the reason we use this common mask, which is like this. Like this, that really is masking most of these differences. And that's the reason we don't normally provide, and we don't, we advise for using this mask and not using all the CMB data, which is available in the archive. So in polarization, we have a similar situation with four methods, Q and U, and they are also quite consistent, although in polarization due to Planck sensitivity and systematics, we have more problems to derive these clean maps, and there are more differences, and the results here are more difficult to reach. So, as I said in the past, in the previous release, these maps were already filtered out for the small multiples, but now all the multiples are included. And here are the pairwise differences for different pairs of component separated maps. And again, we have a mask here, which is going up here as for polarization from the galaxy. And then, apart from this galactic center and this spur, then we have all the rest, which is quite consistent again. So we can also work, as I mentioned previously, from E and B components derived from Q and U. These are invariant under rotations, where Q and U are not. But most of the analysis are based on Q and U, and some of the results are based also on E and B. It's a not easy transformation, and we have to work hard in order to really find a method that are reliable enough to give in a Q and U map with a mask, because we don't want to get this dirt and smooth it around the sky in E and B, and that's the reason we have to impose a mask before doing the transformation, and this is not easy. But again, this is down and is validated. And these are the statistical tests that we have performed in order to really study and analyze the Gaussianity and isotropy of the universe. And these are basic tests. These are blind tests. And this is different from the other Planck result on FNL, which is based on a model, a primordial non-Gaussianity inferred from different non-standard models of inflation. Here we are blind. We don't have any model. We just want to test isotropy and Gaussianity, and this is much harder because not having a model is sometimes you are a bit lost. But still, I think it's worth performing this because we are dealing with basic properties of the universe. And we found in temperature a number of anomalies that we have now studied in polarization, hoping that in polarization we were going to have some extra information in order to decide if these anomalies that are found with no very much significance are real or not, or are statistical flukes. Well, just going through them, the one PDF moment in temperature that resulted in a low variance, basic, especially a small multiples, low resolution, large scales here, 1%, this is the phi value, is at 1% here. And this is also related to the power deficit in the power spectrum, of course. So this is another anomaly that is related and is seen in the power spectrum. This is seen in the map, right? And then this is the situation in polarization. We computed the variance in polarization, Q squared plus U squared, as a function of resolution. And you see that the four methods produces some differences, and this is reflecting the fact, as I mentioned before, that polarization first is not so sensitive. The data in the map is not so precise, and also systematics are can affect more certainly than in temperature. This is, but in any case, the result is that they are consistent, except for this known. So in polarization, we don't see any anomaly. In Minkowski functionals, we don't see neither anomalies. You know the Minkowski functionals that get information from the topology in case of the genus, but also the contour and the area. And you can see here that this is the distribution of the simulations. This is always compared with results from 300 simulations, realistic simulations of the Planck pi line going from TOD to the map and clean CMB maps. So we compare with this distribution and we see that they are compatible. One of the most interesting results of Planck that evidences the sensitivity of Planck in relation to previous missions, in particular WMAP, in polarization is this stacking. Just by having all the maxima above a certain threshold in temperature, we can stack all this maxima in temperature, and also in the same positions in polarization, we do the same, and we expect a specific pattern, theoretical pattern, that can be calculated from the model very easily. And you see here that the pattern in Planck, in QR and UR, which is Q and U, but reference with respect to the center of the maxima, are with a very neat pattern, which is very much in agreement with what is expected from the model. Whereas in this, the situation is much more chaotic in for WMAP here, and you see the difference, right? These are extrema above zero threshold, and this is above three. In both cases, in Planck, in the picture can be seen, and not in WMAP. Okay, so with this stacking, we can also compare with the theoretical model, and we see an effect, which is, this is the result from Planck, and this is what we expect from the simulations, and you see a deficit, there's a difference, the data goes a bit below the model, and this is again related to one of the anomalies we knew about, which is the deficit in the power expected at the low multiples of the, or again, the low variance that we have just seen. And this is seen in the hot and cold spots and different thresholds, maximum and minimum. Okay. So we, another anomaly we found in the past is the cold spot. And here we also see that in temperature, this is a new work, different from Planck, of our group in Santander. And we revisited all the analysis, and we find consistent results, anomaly that is smaller than the prediction of the cosmological model. And then if one normalizes with the model itself, then the anomaly is reduced in significance. And so for having this anomaly, we really are, in a sense, mixing the cold spot itself and the low variance here, when we normalize with the data. Okay. So we did a similar in polarization, a study of the profile in polarization for the cold spot and other spots that were claimed in the past that may be very big and very cold and hot spots. But in particular for the cold spot, we have this in temperature in polarization. As you can see, these are the expectation error bars, these bands here, 1, 2, and 3 sigma. And this is what we expect is the red line. So it's difficult to see from the sensitivity of Planck and cosmic variance limited. And this is the data, so it's difficult to see much here. And therefore, this is consistent in polarization with the standard model. So if we were to find that there was no polarization in the cold spot area, this would mean that the cold spot anomaly could be interpreted as a secondary anisotropy that has no polarization counterpart. But we cannot conclude anything yet. Okay, so there is the last anomaly that I want to comment is the local variance asymmetry found in temperature, and this is asymmetry towards these points here. So these points define a hemisphere in which, in this part of the sky, you have more power than in this part of the sky, and the significance can be up to 0.1%, so it's at the largest scales. So we wanted to see if polarization is giving us some additional information in order to decide if this is again something real or in relation to the nature of this, if this is primordial or secondary, etc. And this is the result. Unfortunately, we don't have a consistent result from the four methods in polarization. So we can have, there are two methods, 7 and Commander, that provides some evidences with p-values smaller than 1%, but there are other two which are the other two, the MICA and NILC, that provide at best case, we always look at here where we have more significance, smaller radius, of the order of several percent. But what is interesting is that in any case, the direction of, if there is an anomaly in polarization, its direction is pointed towards similar direction than the, in temperature. And it seems an interesting coincidence. And these are the p-values of, for the amplitude and for the alignment with temperature, which in some cases, that the problem is that in some cases, two methods produce good significance, and in other two, the significance is not very good. So we don't claim that there is really a polarization anomaly, that we can see a polarization anomaly or signal in the asymmetry, in the sky power asymmetry, but there is a question mark here. So this is something we cannot, unfortunately, we cannot have a strong conclusion here. Well, this is all from Planck, and these are the recent awards that we have received from the Royal Astronomical Society, Gruber Cosmology Prize, and Marcus Grossman, all in relation to the precise determination of the cosmological model, basically. So, and these are all the groups participating. We have ESA and NASA, and all the French leading the HFA, Italy, the low frequency instrument. We are here and here. And then, if I have 5 minutes, I don't know if you are tired enough or you. If we have 5 minutes, we can see a little bit the perspective of 5 minutes. Okay, so there are many other scientific information that can be inferred from CMB data, more quality and sensitive data than Planck, that can be achieved in the future, in the next decade, that is related to more constrained information for inflation, about anomalies. We expect to improve this situation, the neutrino mass scale, light relics, dark matter, dark energy, CMB lensing, and energy injections. If we look at the spectral distortion, up to now, Planck has only dedicated, has been dedicated to the anisotropies, but not anything about, no mission has been launched for spectral distortion. That is another part of the CMB information that is very interesting for cosmology too. So the question here is that now we have to improve much more on the cleaning of the maps. We already have seen from Planck that we need to clean, but if we really want to go further and try to say something or put good constraints on the amplitude of the primordial gravitational waves, in terms of 0.01, the limit now is 0.07, or even smaller, then we have to clean the at the low frequencies. This is the reionization bump, and this is the recombination bump for the signal, the primordial tensor signal. And we have to clean here at this bump at the level of 1%, so we have to remove more than 99% of the foreground contamination, and here at least 66%. So this is really a challenge, right? And this involves much more sensitive detectors, but not only that. But what is more important is much better control of systematics, because these experiments are working for years, collecting data, and the systematics in these few years have to be very precisely controlled and not sudden change, or the changes in time has to be very well modeled to do this, to achieve these levels of sensitivity. So the controversy, we can put it first in terms of if we should have more sensitive from the ground, because the CMB can be, of course, observed from the ground, or from space. And basically the difference is it can be seen here, that from the ground you have the atmosphere, right? And then you have only few windows. These are the Planck frequencies. And you see that there are frequencies in Planck, These are not Planck frequencies. These are the ground windows that we have. And Planck have more frequencies, in particular had one band at 70 GHz that is impossible to observe from the ground. So you have to be constrained to these windows in frequency in order to observe from the ground. In any case, because of the atmosphere and the heat from the optics compared to space, that you are mostly dominated by the CMB background, the noise is coming from the CMB itself, one detector in space is equivalent to 100 detectors from the ground. This is basically the... But this is in sensitivity. If we move to talk about systematics, this is not included here. So systematics are much more difficult from the ground because you are affected by many, many other quantities like changes in temperature, water vapor, etc. Whereas in space you don't have these problems. So there are already going on experiments, in particular in the States. They are very much advanced. We are in stage 3 here, like with this sensitivity, thousands of detectors. Basically, in two sites in the Earth, in South Pole and Atacama, with SPT and BICEP in the South Pole, and ACT and Polar Bear in Atacama. At the end, this should converge in 2027 in what is called stage 4, which is almost or partially already funded in the States. And this will involve of the order of 500,000 detectors in these sites, which is huge compared to the present situation, which is only tens of thousands. And these are pictures of these experiments. There are some European contribution to this effort, but is led by states. Here we have the European consortium. We try to coordinate in Europe, and we have already 4 years talking and trying to coordinate, and has not been very easy. I'm involved in these discussions, in particular from Spain here. And at the end, it seems that this year we have started to converge in something like three different experiments, one related to small aperture telescopes, basically to measure the what we call the primordial gravitational waves. But not only that, also a large aperture telescope is a company and a group in Germany that is able to produce large telescope of 6 meters with very, very large focal planes of the order of more than 1 meter, 1.5 meters, which is a significant improvement with respect to the present. And also, we are very much involved in this initiative, which is the low frequency covering from 40 GHz to 120, and basically putting one telescope in the northern hemisphere in Tenerife and another one in the southern hemisphere. So in 2027, we expect to converge, because the situation is here now, to something like this, in which we will have two main technology instrumentation, which one for high and another for low frequency. And we are thinking also in the possibility of applying for an ESPRI, you know. So this is the situation in Tenerife with three experiments. We are in Santander, we are involved in Quijote, but there is also this Italian experiment covering similar frequencies, but higher frequencies also here, SPE and STRIP, and Ground Bird, which is based on kids, is Japanese-led experiment, and is covering the higher frequencies. We'll see what comes from this, but these three experiments, the good thing is that they are covering the same part of the sky, which is interesting, at very different frequencies. So this is the description of the low frequency full sky survey that we expect to be able to build, and we expect also to get sensitivities with these plans of the order of 10 to minus 3. But this is something we are working on yet. Post-Planck. So there have been a number of submissions to different agencies for different missions like Core, Core Plus, I have been involved in all of these. LIBOR is the one which is led by JAXA and is in the best situation now because it's been evaluated, and maybe in 1 month's time we may know that this is accepted It can continue. And there is a European consortium involved in labor. I am involved in labor too. And also there's plans in NASA, this PICO, which is a project that has been funded by NASA, but it's at the level of a project. Nothing serious yet, but maybe in the future it can evolve to something real. And has been over this pristine, which is for spectrum, but it was not approved in the first call now. I proposed this CalSat for calibration in the first call, but it didn't succeed. And this is also this initiative from India. So this is LIBOR, and LIBOR is with two different experiments, and the European contribution goes to this high-frequency telescope covering these frequencies. And there's a consortium with conversation with ESA trying to contribute to this, but we are now in a very critical time in which we will know in a few weeks if at the end we will involve and construct part of this instrumentation or not, or even if the labor mission itself goes towards a real mission or not. Well, this is the final slide with all the European consortium and leadership from different countries. And you can see the picture there. Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have time for some questions now. Who's the first one?
Thank you, Enrique, for this very nice talk and the insight, very dense of many results. I have many questions, maybe from my ignorance, but I have one that the first one is about the tension between the Planck results and the supernova, in this case, result from H0. What do you think the 3.6 is? Of course, it's a statistically significant difference, but what's your opinion about that? Is it systematic? Is something that's telling us something? What's your opinion about that? And the second would be, just more speculative from my side, what do you think about the cold spot origin?
Okay, about the first question, of course, I am biased. I work on the CMB. And I believe much more what I do in relation to other experiments that I am not involved in. So I trust very much Planck results. I think they are very robust, as I have tried to show. And in particular, the high parameter has been very stable value from Planck from the years. And the question here is, in relation to supernovae, from my point of view, I am not an expert in this analysis of the supernovae data, but I know that there are many, many things that you have to calibrate, etc. And therefore, my opinion may be that either there is a systematics inside the supernovae analysis, or if not, then we don't understand our universe, right? Then there is something going on in which the Hubble expansion of the universe is faster now than is expected from the values measured at recombination by Planck. And I cannot say more than that, but from all the pictures I showed, I think there are other supernova data, but not only involving the local ones, but higher redshifts, in which new data, the function data in particular, they are consistent with Planck results. So this is the situation. About the second question, the origin of the cold spot. So the cold spot is still something that I prefer, even if I like to talk about the possibility of being something real, and also all the other anomalies. I have to recognize that this is not very significant anomaly. It's at the level, all the anomalies I showed is always, and this is the difficulty of interpretation, is at the level of 3 sigmas. And the thing is that we wanted in Planck to shed more light on the nature of these anomalies, in particular if there is, because the interesting thing about these anomalies is because the cosmological model is very boring, right? We expected with a new mission, a new experiment, we always expect to have something new, really new, but with Planck, there's nothing new. It's just the plain vanilla lambda CDM model, right? But these anomalies could be a hint of new physics there, maybe related to the early universe. And this is the interesting thing. And the cold spot in this case, we try to model this with a texture, a topological defect. But again, Planck is constraining very much the topological defects. So for me, the most important thing, more than any interpretation, and other people have tried to interpret this as the result of a void. From the what we know about gravity and voids, we don't think you can explain this huge amplitude with a void. But also, I have to say that we don't, from the point of view of the CMB, we don't understand very well the voids, because there are also other anomalies in relation to catalogs of voids, which seem to indicate some controversial results between what is expected from the gravity of these voids and the result. So it seems that we find more signal in relation to voids than it is expected. So there is something there interesting, but we cannot say more than that.
Let me ask you then. I have several things, but just to put the things a little bit into the context for the future, okay? What is the experiments of Tenerife, I mean Quixote and all the other two you have mentioned, going to add with respect to the results that Planck has already provided, especially referring to the lambda cold dark matter model, whether you think that you can get anything from there that could put, yes, there, you know, okay, some intriguing questions, I don't know.
Yes.
Anisotropies and the cosmological model is trying to see, to measure the signal of the primordial gravitational waves, the B mode. We know what is expected in terms of the power spectrum, and we just need to go towards more sensitivity and more detectors, etc. So Quixote in particular doesn't have more sensitivity than Planck. But it's covering other frequencies, lower frequencies than Planck. And in this way, we are able to constrain a major foreground for the CMB, which is the synchrotron, in particular in polarization.
That's what I was going to say.
Yes. So this is needed anyway, because normally you don't expect to have very low frequencies in a mission, because in space, volume and weight is very important. And then to measure 10 gigahertz or 20, you need very big horns, and you don't have this space is needed for the other horns, right? For sensitivity, to put more detectors in the mission. So the focal plane is very much limiting your ability to cover a very large fraction of frequency range, in particular in the low frequency. So this is important to cover from the ground, and this is the role of Quixote, in particular, thinking in the future of missions like Lightbird, that we can complement very well to Lightbird frequencies at frequencies below 40 GHz. And then in the future, we plan these low frequency instruments and experiments in which the problem with Tenerife is that it's the only now available site to observe the CMB in the northern hemisphere. There are other sites that potentially can be of interest, higher places in Himalaya, in China, or in the Greenland. But however, there is no infrastructure there, and there are other problems that at the moment there is not this possibility. So we will have Tenerife, and in Tenerife, due to the altitude, we cannot observe. We don't know, but probably we are very not very optimal to observe above 120 GHz. And that's the reason. But even with this range, from, let's say, 10 to 120 GHz, we believe we have preliminary results indicating that it's possible to be competitive and be sensitive to really detect the R parameter.
For Camion, I think it has been a very nice overview of the results that Planck has provided in the result of the long history of mission. I am sure that there will be many new results still coming, although the final data release has already been produced. But
we believe that Planck will survive in the next decade. There is no other mission planned for the next decade, and therefore this data will be there, and it will be important to consider it, because there will not be other better data in the next decade, basically.
I think you will have now the advantage that you can read the papers and understand better what is written there. Okay, many thanks.